Let's pray. Father, we thank this opportunity you've given us to gather together in this, your place.
Yes.
Holy Spirit, you are the great teacher. We simply ask that you do what you do best. Open the eyes of our understanding. Bring to us a spirit of wisdom and revelation. May your word that is alive come alive in us. May your word that is powerful be powerful in us. I come against the strongholds right now in people's minds in the name of Jesus. May the truth set us free.
Yes. Amen.
So we welcome the truth. Yes. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen and amen. We're going to go back to some basic beginnings, and we're going to, I have a point to where we're going, but I've got to lay this foundation first. We're going to be reading out of the book of Matthew, chapter 3, and we're going to talk about the very first. When Jesus was anointed for ministry, he was baptized. And this is first mentioned in Matthew chapter 3, going into chapter 4. One of the greatest issues that I see that are lacking in the body of Christ is people's value and dignity. Compared to what the Word says about us, and compared to how we live it, or if we do live it, or if we even understand it, we're not seeing it. Let me share it this way. Verse 16 in chapter 3 of the book of Matthew. When he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water. And behold, the heavens were opened to him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly, say the word suddenly.
Suddenly.
I like that. You need to prepare for the suddenlies of God.
Amen.
And
Amen.
Suddenly, a voice or a sound. See, some people heard a voice and some people heard a
sound
or a thundering. Very good. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved son, say son, in whom I'm well pleased. Then the tempter was, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread.
Can you hand me that Bible?
What this is understanding, what I want you to understand in the reading of this, is that this is the first temptation of Jesus Christ. But what is the first temptation of Jesus Christ? Is the first temptation of Jesus Christ to turn the stones into bread? That's not the first temptation. The first temptation of Jesus Christ is to doubt what he had just heard. The first temptation of Jesus Christ was, if you be the Son of God, do something to prove it. Now, I love Gil going into this, talking about turning the stones into bread. Real quickly, what was written engraved on stones on Mount Sinai?
The law.
So can we take a parallel? Can we take the stones and say the stones that the law was written on are the same stones symbolically of the stones that the tempter was telling Jesus to turn into bread? Yes, we can. He was literally saying, turn the stone. You gotta remember that the Bible communicates on multiple levels at any one time. There's the surface understanding and what the Bible is saying on the surface. And then there's another level of revelation. And then there's going to be another level of revelation. And there's no end to the revelation within God's Word. Does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
So on the surface, it is, turn the stones into bread because he was hungry. Guess what? There was nothing wrong with doing that. There is no Levitical law written in scriptures that you can't, if you're hungry, turn a stone into bread and eat it. He could have turned it into roast beef. He could have had a Happy Meal. Brisket. You know, he could have had
brisket,
a pizza.
Yeah.
Brisket. 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 Oh, oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. He could have had briskets and ribs. And bacon. Or, what was this? Or a salad. So there is nothing in the Levitical law saying you couldn't do that. So the temptation wasn't to do that. The temptation was to, by your actions, prove who you are. Because he was being challenged in who he was. It's, if you be the Son of God, what had he just heard when he came up out of the water from God his Father? It says this, "This is my beloved Son, in whom he's well pleased." What had he done? He hadn't done, this is the beginning of his ministry. He hadn't done anything. I mean, we're not going to go back into the history of what was actually going on, but there was, so his pleasing the Father wasn't based on what he did or what he didn't do. Did you hear that, church?
Yes.
So many of us believe that the pleasing of the Father comes from our performance. So many of us believe that our Christianity comes from our performance, or our lack of performance, our inability in our minds to do what we think the Word's asking us to do. And that's the trap that Jesus did not fall for, but that's the trap that we have fallen for. It says, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Jesus wasn't going, on the surface level, he wasn't going to fall for the trap of what is called performance-based Christianity. Performance-based Christianity is the Christianity or the lifestyle, or let's put it this way, the religion of man. It literally is the religion of man. If you think, what was the first thing that Adam did after he ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? He took a fig leaf and he covered his issues that were manifested with what he thought he could do. In other words, he performed something that wasn't good enough for God. That was the first attempt for man to have religion. It was the first humanistic religion, was putting the fig leaf, what man could do to cover up a sin. You can't do anything to cover your sin. God had to show him. It had to be through blood, so he had to take the skin of an animal and provide for that covering as an example, as a testimony that blood had to be shared. So, what we see in this, and we're not going to go all through this because this is a great teaching. You need to understand the basic principles of the first temptations of Jesus Christ. So here again it says, verse 4, "But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every what?
Word
that proceeds out of the mouth of God." What were the words that Jesus just heard out of the mouth of his Father? "This is my beloved." See, the very essence of man, the very strength, the vitality, the what makes you get up in the morning, what caused Jesus was telling us right here, it's not going to come or should not be coming from your performance. It should be coming according to what God says about you.
That's right.
The problem is the church as a whole doesn't understand how God sees us. We're still seeing us according to our opinion. We still see us according to our past or our present, and it's affecting our future. Because we're not seeing us from his reality. We're seeing ourselves from our reality. And we're not walking in the victory that Jesus came to bring us and what he walked in. We're supposed to walk like Jesus walked, talk like Jesus. We're supposed to be like Christ. Matter of fact, Jesus came to be about his Father's business, and that's our job. Our job, in the gospel, according to the gospel, is to find hell on earth and bring heaven to it. Mm-hmm. Why in the world are Christians trying to get out of here? I believe that we're going to get out of here someday, but when we get out of here, guess what? We're coming back to rule and reign on earth. Does everybody understand it? Man was created for the planet earth, and God hasn't changed his mind. Okay? Watch this. Verse 5. Then the devil took him up to the holy city and set him on a pinnacle of the temple. In American English, American understanding, we can replace that word temple with what? Say church.
Church. Church.
He took him to church! That's right, he was right. He took him to church. Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the highest point, the pinnacle of the temple, which was the church at that time, and said to him, if you are the... There it is again. The something to challenge his identity by doing something to prove it. Listen to me, church. If you can prove that you're a Christian by what you do, I can prove you're not a Christian by what you don't do. Do you want to play this game? See how easy it is to not walk in victory? Would you base your value and your dignity and your self-worth on your performance instead of his performance and what God says about you? You will always walk in a way that's less than, oh, let me put it this way. You'll always be affected by the Antichrist that's in you. We all have something, an opinion about ourselves that's less than God's opinion about us. You understand that? God doesn't see you according to your past. He sees you according to his kingdom.
Amen.
Period. Okay? Watch this. So he took him up and says, verse 6, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written. See, he even used the word of God here, didn't he? The tempter used the word of God. Now, I'm going to say it in a way that it might be a little more familiar to you. If you're a good Christian, you would be at church every Sunday. If you're a good Christian, you would serve the church all the time.
No.
If you are a good Christian, you would give everything that you have to give.
I do that.
Does everybody understand? Does everybody understand the performance issue here? If you are a good... See, you shouldn't do what you're doing to become something that you already are. What you already are should determine what you do. Look at the problem. Look at the issue with... If this principle is true, we should find it somewhere else in Scripture. Adam and Eve. The tempter came to who? Adam or Eve?
Eve.
Why did the tempter come to Eve and not Adam?
Because she was easy.
Wow. We need to understand that Eve had never heard the Word of God. Eve was told the Word of God.
Yes.
Eve was a rib. When Adam heard God speak to him about not eating the tree, she was still a rib. And the only person that could tell her not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil added something to it and said, don't touch it or eat it, lest you die. Because faith comes by what?
Hearing.
Did she hear the word of God? No, yeah. She was told the word of God. Jesus said here, says man's going to live by the very word of God that they hear. Not that they're told. We've got to hear the word of God. Not being told the word. We go to church and we're told the word. But in the telling of the word, we need to be hearing the word of God in our own heart. We need to understand. And that's what we're talking about tonight. We're not going to talk about all, there's a whole teaching in all of this about the different temptations, what they mean. Turn over to, matter of fact, in another portion of the Gospels where it talks about the same thing, at the end it said that Satan or the tempter left for a more opportune time. Guess when that opportune time was?
Before the cross.
Jesus is hanging on the cross. And the Roman centurion looks up and said, if you be the Son of God, do something to prove it. Pull yourself down. He could have called 10,000 angels.
But he did.
If he would have, it would have catapulted us into performance-based Christianity.
Yeah.
But he didn't want us to live that way. But religion causes us to live that way. Look at 2 Peter, excuse me, Matthew chapter 17. Real familiar passage of scripture for a lot of people. It's what is known in churchdom as the Mount Transfiguration.
Mm.
But we've deemed it a different name called the Mountain of Transfer. Mm. This is not just, see, because that little subtitle, Mountain of Transfiguration, oh, Jesus got transfigured, let's go to the next. No, that happened, but that's not what took place. Mm. There's so much more that took place on this Mountain of Transfer. What took place? Moses and Elijah, Jesus were standing there. Peter, James, and John, in that order, were looking up and they saw Jesus transfigured. But what was happening at the time? Moses and Elijah, which represented the Old Covenant, was transferring the authority over to Jesus. We need to understand that. That law came via Moses, but grace and truth came to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
So law was in control, or the dominant authority under the Old Covenant, but now they transferred the authority to Jesus, and he didn't bring the law. He brought
grace
and truth. We need to understand. Now, in that process, on this mountain, this is what it said. I love this. Peter looks up and sees this happening. He said, Jesus, do you want us to build three tabernacles? One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. See, that's just like a man, a person with, you know, as soon as God does something spectacular, we want to build a building.
Building program.
We have a building program. Take up an offering, you know, start another building. Set something. And before, I believe before the breath was out of his mouth, I believe what the scripture says here, that God spoke.
Mm-hmm.
That God spoke. He said, this is my beloved son. Hear him. He didn't say them. Because all their history, they had listened to the law and the prophets for guidance and direction. That came to an end on the Mountain of Transfiguration, or the Mountain of Transfer, when the authority was being. And God himself said, this is my beloved son. What? The same thing that he heard in the very, it was a confirmation that Jesus, and what we're going to talk about is what Jesus felt. Just not what they experienced, but see, Jesus felt something. Oh, that's what we need to talk about. We're talking about the affirmation of God in our life. We need to have it. We need to hear it. We need to understand it. Oh, you'll never walk in the victory and the promises that are yes and amen in your life. God said, this is my beloved son, hear him. And from that point on, matter of fact, they were going to tell everybody about it, but Jesus said, they're coming down the mountain. Jesus goes, don't tell nobody about this. Can you believe that? You get a word from God like that, you hear God directly on your own ears, and Jesus says, don't tell nobody. He said, don't tell anybody until, say
until.
The Son of Man is risen from the grave. What does that mean? Think about it. What happened when the Son of Man was risen from the grave? The old covenant came to an end and the new covenant beginning. So under the old covenant, they still had to listen to the law of the prophets. But under the new covenant, it is the teachings of Jesus Christ, full of grace and truth, not law. Man, the motivation under the law was fear. The motivation under grace and truth is love.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I tell you what, church,
amen.
There's so much fear being talked about. Fear is the atmosphere of the old covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, I love the scripture in Romans chapter 7. Put Romans chapter 7, verse 4.
I ain't going nowhere.
Romans chapter 7, verse 4. This is literally talking about, if you read verse 1, it's talking, the Apostle Paul is literally talking. The book of Romans is written to everybody that were in Rome that were part of the body of Christ. And verse 1 says, "Or do you not know, brethren, for I speak to those who know the law." So all the message, all so far, chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, have been talking to everybody. And now he turns to a small group of people that were there, those that had been Jews that were saved, that knew the law of Moses. It says, go back to where you were. That's good. "Or do you not know, brethren, I speak to those who know the law, that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives?" Still talking to the Jews that know the law. For the you need to understand that. The Gentiles didn't know the law, and they didn't have to. You won't find any place in Scripture where Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, took the Torah and taught the Gentiles the law. But how? What did he teach them? The Scripture says he taught them the mystery, not the history. Man, that's powerful. "For the woman who has a husband is bound by the law to her husband as long as he lives. But if the husband dies, she is released from the law of her" what? "Husband. So then, if while her husband lives, she marries another man, she will be..." Now, if she... Okay, I'll say this again. "So then, if while her husband lives..." In other words, if the law of her husband is still alive, "she marries another man, she'll be called a" what? "An adulteress. But if her husband dies," or if the law of her husband dies, "she is free from the law," because it's dead, "so that she is not an adulteress, though she has married another man. Therefore," say therefore.
"Therefore,
therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law." Who's he speaking to? Those that knew the law, the Jews that understood the law of Moses. And I'm talking about all the law. He doesn't say partial. "Therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law." I'm going to add this. "You become dead to the law of Moses through the body of Christ." Boy, that's a communion scripture right there. If you've never seen communion the way we... There are some communion scriptures that haven't been taught in the church that need to be taught in the church.
Come to Pelican Rapids.
Well, come next
week.
Yeah, come to Pelican Rapids.
Next Saturday?
Yeah. Next Saturday.
Next Saturday, Pelican Rapids, we're going to go through this teaching of communion. We need to fill the house.
Mm-hmm.
"Therefore, my brethren, you also become dead to the law of Moses through the body..." That's the wafer. That's the bread.
Yep.
"That was broken." So, in communion, do this in remembrance of Him. What's that mean? Oh, I remember, because of your body, I'm free from the law of Moses.
Amen.
Why? So you can just do what you want to do? No. "That you may be married to another." That's Jesus. "To Him who was raised from the dead, that we should" what?
"Amen.
Go to heaven?"
No.
It's not about going to heaven.
Right.
Quit it. It's about bearing fruit on earth. It's about being an example of His goodness and His greatness through the way we live. But we're not living that way because we don't see ourselves the way the Word sees us. Does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
How was Jesus able to do what He did? Because He was 100% man and 100% God. Amen? You understand that? Watch this. So, He heard, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." At the beginning of His ministry, here on the Mount of Transfiguration, He hears it again. Turn over to 2 Peter. I don't hear any pages. That's because everybody's looking up at the TV. Someone make me a program with pages flipping. I like that. I won't feel so alone. 2 Peter. Where's 2 Peter? There it is. It's after 1st. What? Verse 16. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. "For we..." Now, who's writing this book?
Peter's
writing this book. This is the second letter he's written to this group of people. Listen to this. Now, who was on the Mountain of Transfiguration or transfer?
Peter,
James, and John. "For we," meaning Peter, James, and John, "did not follow cunningly devised fables when
we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were witnesses. See, Peter was a witness, just not a witness, but were eyewitnesses of his what?
Majesty.
For he received from God the Father what?
Honor.
Look what it says. What did he receive?
Honor
and
glory.
When did he receive that? For he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory. What? This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well. When he heard God call him beloved Son and him being well pleased, it brought Jesus what?
Honor
and glory. Wonder why Jesus said that we need to walk and live. The very essence of, or the very energy, the very reason we get up in the morning is because we know that we've heard God tell us that we're His children. And He's well pleased and we're beloved. And when you hear that, nothing will steal that from you. The only thing that will keep you from seeing that in your life is if you still live under performance-based Christianity. If you think God thinks less of you when you sin, your heart is saturated and engulfed in performance-based Christianity religion. Man, that's introduction. Can we go from there? James chapter 1. I had to paint that picture.
You're all painted yellow.
Oh, I don't like yellow.
There you go.
James chapter 1, verse 2. And actually, this is written to the 12 tribes scattered abroad. We have to keep things in context that way. But in verse 2 it says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. I'm going to stop right here for a second, and I've got to take a little sidetrack. I want you to see something here. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8. I'm going to read this. It says, whom having not seen you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory. Verse 9. Receiving the end. Say end.
End.
Of what? Receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your soul. Your soul is your thoughts, your feelings, your emotions. Say emotions.
Emotion.
Say it nice and loud. Emotions.
Emotions.
You can have saved emotions. Your faith, yes, faith is used to change things. But the word end of your faith, do you see what it says that?
Yeah.
Receiving the end, it doesn't mean when your life comes to an end. It means the purpose of your faith. The reason you have faith. It means the immediate purpose, the ultimate purpose, and the prophetic purpose of your faith is the salvation of your soul. Not going to heaven, but while on earth. Yes, faith is for changing things. But its main purpose is to change you. Faith isn't necessarily about making things change according to the way you want them to. See, Paul was on his way to Rome on a boat he didn't want to be on.
Yep.
That was a great message right there. I started thinking about that today. That, yeah, you remember the message we talked about in Acts 20, 25 about shaking it off? Yeah, does anybody here for that one? You got to shake it off. Have you ever been in a situation where you were there because somebody else's stupid decision?
Oh, yeah.
Paul was on a ship that he wasn't supposed to be on. In a storm, he told them not to go out into, and they did anyway. You ever been with a group of people that decided to do something, and you said, hey, you shouldn't be doing that. And they did it, and you got stuck with them?
Yep.
That's life. That's life.
Uh-oh.
Now, did Paul go through a shipwreck?
Yep.
You know, we have an opportunity when those things happen. I'm not going to bring up politics. I'm not going to do that. But America is in a wreck right now.
It so is.
Okay? Now, we have, see, Paul had an opportunity to look at his circumstances and get all under the weather. And look at the situation and let the situation steal his joy. But see, he had a word from the Lord that he was supposed to be somewhere. Even if he had a word from the Lord, he could have got caught up, but he didn't see the wreck. He ended up seeing the revival.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because when the world looks like a wreck all around you, God is preparing you for a revival. It all depends. See, I believe with all my heart, God is preparing America for a revival. So I'm excited. I don't like the stuff that's happening, but in the spirit, I'm excited. Which are we supposed to be moved by? The stuff or the spirit? Even if the rapture comes and we get out of here, do you realize how great a revival is going to hit the planet Earth when all of a sudden millions and millions of people that have been telling people about the coming of the Lord aren't here anymore, and then they repent and they should have listened? The greatest revival the world's ever going to know is the one that comes after the church leaves the... People are going to repent. Come on. Come on. We got to think that way. We got to believe that way. See, that's the hope that's set before us. Now, I got to get back. I'm sorry. I wasn't supposed to go there.
That ties into that shipwreck story because God gave favor to all the people that were with Paul. He didn't have to, but he gave favor to all those people and saved all their lives.
If you ever want to read the great, other than the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that is the second best story in the Bible. I'm telling you right now. Because it's so relevant to the way we live today. I love what it says, and I'm just going to quote some of it. I'm not going to take time to read it, or I'll be in it all night long. But you got to remember that, you know, when everybody thought their life was over, Paul said, don't worry.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The God that I serve. Oh,
I love it.
You know, you can feel it. It's like Superman pulling back the shirt going, I'm looking like Clark Kent right now, but here's the moment. The God that I serve.
Yes.
Do you realize they treated him like a leper? They didn't want to talk to him. Why was he on that boat in the first place? Because he was declaring the things the God that he serves says. And now, they're all scared they're going to die. And he says, no, don't worry, have no fear. We're going to lose everything. But except not one hair on your head is going to be lost. No life is going to be lost. He says, the God that I serve said so.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah.
Are we standing up and declaring what God is saying in the midst of adversity while everybody else is panicking, figuring they're going to lose their life? Man, I tell you, you look at all the things. Quit reading past stuff and meditate on this stuff. There's stuff in there like they threw over all their tackle. For days, that means they can't really steer. They couldn't see. The heavens were clouded for days. That means they had no way to tell which way was north and south, east and west. They couldn't navigate. You ever been in life and realized you've lost all control?
Oh, yeah.
And there's nothing you can do, and you just gotta...
Or stay down.
Man, I tell you, I got to get off it. We'll be on it all night. But I love what it says. They came ashore. It had been raining. It was cold this whole time. They were out there for days and days and days and days and days and days and days. It wasn't a short trip. They were lucky to hit the reef. Not lucky. I think it was all planned. They hit the reef. Paul grabbed a 2x4 and floated to shore. See, there's some storms in life, like Jesus, you speak to, and they go away in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
There's some storms that shouldn't even bother you, and Jesus just walked through them.
Amen.
But the only reason he stopped that storm was because of other people's lack of faith. That storm wasn't bothering Jesus.
He's sleeping.
And there's some storms you just got to hang on to a 2x4 and float through, knowing that God's got purpose for you on the other side of the storm. That no matter what happens to you, it's not going to keep you from doing what God's called you to do. And I love the story. This is what the story all ends up being, is that the natives, it says, the barbarians. It was an island called Malta. I love that. You remember that? I mean, that was a powerful message. That was good. The whole town had the Malta fever and dysentery. Do you know? You may explain dysentery.
No,
it's okay. It's bad.
I know it.
They had too much Malta meal.
Yeah, that Malta fever was creating some Malta meal, is what it was. Hey, I like Malta meal.
Your problems are multiplied.
So the barbarians or the natives of the island saw these people there. And they started a fire for him. But Paul, being a good minister, he didn't sit back and let everybody do the work like other ministers do. He got up and was going to help build the fire. He got this bundle of wood. Now be careful. Did the snake bite him then? No. Now when you build a fire, if there was a fire in the middle, is it cold outside?
Yeah.
And it's, no, is it cold inside? Yes. No.
Yeah,
is it? Okay. So if it's cold outside and you build a fire, which way are you going to? Are you going to not look at the fire? Or are you going to sit as close as you can and look at it? So there's 200 plus people around this fire. It's a big bonfire, and they're cold and they're wet, and they're gathered around the fire. And Paul brings over a bundle of wood. Which way is everybody looking? Everybody can see Paul with a bundle of wood, right? Because they're looking at the fire. Where's Paul standing? At the fire. Has the snake bit him yet? No. It wasn't until he reached to the middle of the fire and set the bundle of wood on the fire that everybody's looking at, that the snake reached out in. I love what the scriptures, just don't read it. Feel it. I love what it says, it latched on. Oh yeah, you feel it, don't you? It didn't bite him.
Ugh.
See, a snake can bite and get away, right?
He creepy crawled.
But no, it latched. It like, ha!
Ooh.
Yep.
It latched on. And Paul's standing there going, oh, look, a snake. And everybody is seeing it. You know why? Because it's hanging on, it's latched on. It's not coming off. Now, this is where the world's watching you. How are you going to go through your adversities?
Shake it off.
What did Paul do? He shook it off. He shook it off. So this is what we got to do to our problems. We got to learn the world's watching, and we need to shake it off. Shake it off. I love what the rest of the scripture says. The rest of scripture says the people in Malta, the natives, the barbarians, they said, he really must have been a murderer. Even though he escaped this death of the sea, justice has got him, and now he's going to die. And this is what it says. And they set back to see if he would puff up. Now, that sounds like people in the church.
Yes.
You go through a problem in life. You can you say amen?
Amen?
You go through a problem in life. Now, how many of them? Look, watch. This is the. How many of them rush to help him?
No.
So you preach it. Not one of them came to give him first aid or to help. They said, "Oh, look, he got bit. He's going to die. Let's watch him puff up."
You must have deserved it.
You know how many people in the church do that when they hear through someone going through a hard time in church that had a problem, a situation that they didn't plan on, they didn't cause. They're reaping what somebody else sowed in life. And we sit back, oh, obviously, they did something wrong to deserve it.
Job's friends, that's what they are.
And they sat back and watched him puff up and waited for him to die. I love that verse. That's a cool verse. And they sat there and watched. And they realized, oh, goodness. He didn't puff up. He didn't die. He must be a god.
No, because he didn't.
Wait a minute. That shows you how fickle people are. 1 minute, they're judging what happened to you because of something that they think you did that you didn't do.
Yep.
And they're going, huh? Well, he's going to die. He deserves it. He didn't die. He must be a god. Wait a minute. He went from being a murderer that no one wanted to talk to, nobody wanted to help, to being a god that everybody wanted to be around him now. The rest of the story is, for 3 days, the governor of the island was taking care of him. Why? Not because he was a murderer. Because they thought he was a god. All because of the way he dealt with the issue that was at hand. Did y'all get that pun?
Yeah.
Did I enjoy it more than you did?
Yeah.
Okay. I thought it was pretty good. Wait a minute, I'll preach it myself. That was pretty good. Okay. The issue that was at hand. And so here's the thing. Paul's sitting there getting taken care of. And everybody's talking to Paul. They didn't want to hear what he had to say. That's why he was on the boat. And now he realizes that the father of the governor of the island had, what do we call it? Malta fever and dysentery. And he was about ready to die. Paul walks into the room, puts the same hand that the devil meant for evil, God used the same hand to bring the miracle.
Amen.
Don't underestimate the power of what you're going through.
Tell it.
What the devil meant for evil in your life, God can use it for good.
Amen.
The whole island, revival hit the whole island. See, Paul had an opportunity. He says, what am I going to do? I'm stuck on this island. It's cold. There's a fire. I've been bit by a snake. I shook it off. What am I going to do? And I believe in his heart, he said, well, I'm going to do the same thing that I did in Jerusalem. I'm going to do in Malta. He spoke the gospel and healed people.
Amen.
See, the question I've got for you tonight, in the situation, the wreck that this world is in, the world, child sex trafficking worldwide?
Tell it.
Come on. Evil, rampant. Righteous people are becoming evil, and evil's becoming righteous.
That's great.
Christian children can't talk about God, but they let the Muslim children talk about Allah in school.
Yeah.
They let the gay kids talk about their transition into what they want to be. But the Christian kids can't talk about anything about God. See, the world is this way, but what are we looking at, the shipwreck of the world, or are we looking for the revival that's coming to the world? Man, we need to be looking. We need to understand, what are you going to do in this situation? Well, hopefully, It's the same. If you were walking in the Spirit, the same thing you did before that shipwreck happened. Are you going to be a testimony of God's goodness? But the problem is, we don't see ourselves the way God sees us, and that's what we're talking about here tonight. Look at what it says here. Let's go ahead and read. Where did I leave off in 1 Peter?
Mm-hmm. Nine.
Let's just start reading at verse...
Nine. You were on nine.
I was on nine? No.
The end of your faith.
Oh, I see. Receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your, that is your thoughts, your feelings, your emotions, and the will. And I'm going to say this out loud, and I think that's being recorded. I don't know. I'm always being recorded. I'm held accountable for it. It's not the scripture that you read that will change and affect your life. It's the imagination you have that you put on the scripture that you read. How you see the scripture working in your life will determine how it's going to work in your life, if at all. If you read a scripture about healing the sick and you can't see yourself laying your hands on people and healing the sick, that scripture will never happen in your life. Until you can see it manifesting through you, because God's working through you on this planet. God's not doing it without you. He's doing it through you. You understand that? If you don't see yourself high and lifted up, if you don't see yourself as a child of God, if you don't see yourself being loved by the loving Father that you have in heaven, you'll never experience it. Your imagination determines how the scripture that you read affects your life. I'll show you that. Turn to the book of James, chapter 1. Ha ha! Everybody say, ha ha! Verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall in various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Listen to this next verse. But let him ask in
faith.
That was pretty poor. Let's try it one more time. But let him ask in
faith
with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a
wave of the sea.
Like a what?
Wave of the sea, driven and tossed
by the
wind.
We just talked about a story that had waves and wind in it. But him let him ask in what? Faith with no doubting. See, I heard this taught. Joy and I met each other. Yeah, we did. Long time ago. In Tulsa, Oklahoma, the Jerusalem of America. Oh, you never heard that? Oh, Tulsa. That's where all the faith teachers were at.
Actually, I heard the other day, Tulsa-Rusalem.
Tulsa-Rusalem. We met in Tulsa, Oklahoma. It was the birthplace of the faith movement. And we were taught, and everybody was taught, that if you ever get to the point where you have faith in God's word and you don't doubt, it'll happen.
Yeah.
Right? That's You've heard right. that?
Yeah. Word of faith.
Got a question. Does anybody in here doubt that God is not able to do whatever he wants to do. Is there any doubt in here?
No.
No, not here.
So it's not a doubt that God is not able. It's not a doubt that his word is not true. God's not a liar and his word is true, correct?
Correct.
So where's the doubting? Let me explain it. The doubting is, we doubt that he'd do it for us.
Yep. He'll do it for him, but not me.
That's... He'll do it for somebody else, but he won't do it for me. I'm not... That's the issue. Performance-based relationship and provision and promises. The promises of God are what? Yes and amen. The doubting is not doubting if God can do it. The doubting is not doubting that the word is true. The doubting is not doubting that God would do it for somebody else. The doubting is,
will he heal me?
And we doubt that we've done enough. Wow. Because we haven't heard, well done, good and faithful servant. We haven't heard, this is my beloved daughter and son, in whom I'm well pleased. Outside of the realm of your performance. Does everybody hear that? Because we've lived in a performance-based Christianity, we don't believe that God would do that for me. I'm not worthy. There's denominations out there, they make it their job to tell you you're not worthy. I got news for you. Oh, yes, you are.
Amen.
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 You're so valuable. What did Jesus receive when he heard, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased? He received honor and glory. When we start walking with the honor and glory that God has bestowed upon us because we're his family, we will start receiving the promises that are yes and amen. That in 2 Peter says everything that pertains to life and godliness has already been given to us. But we're not worthy of that. We're just, there's some people believe, there are some boards that believe it's their job to keep their pastor humble. Come on. And poor. You've been around a while. Come on, church. When we, Jesus said that the essence of man's not going to live. Notice it doesn't say humans. Now we know why. We're not going to go that detail, but God didn't make humans. He made man in his image. Had the Spirit of God in him. And it didn't say humans. It says man's not going to live by bread alone. If you are a man with the Spirit of God inside of you, you were a human, you got born again, the Spirit of God came inside of you, now you're a man the way God originally created man. You found the missing part in Jesus. You were born from above. And it says those men, the way the ones I created, those that have the same DNA as me, they're going to live according to my opinion of them. Oh. And when you understand the fullness of God's opinion with you, you won't let the things you do in the flesh keep you from walking in the Spirit. I guarantee you, you see yourself in love with God and God in love with you enough and you'll quit doing the things that war against your soul. Since the scripture says that sin wars against your soul, it doesn't war against God. It tears you up. It doesn't tear God up. God took care of your sin at Calvary.
It tore him up.
Forgiveness doesn't do God any good. I know this stuff you hadn't heard before. You know what makes forgiveness so important? You know what? Repentance. Repentance doesn't do God any good. You know what repentance is for? It does you good. It keeps you in your place, knowing that you're going to... See, when you sin, you are in your world. When you repent, you're in His. When you sin, you weren't in the kingdom, in the flesh. You were in the world's kingdom. When you repent, you're in the kingdom's. You see what I'm saying? Approach the throne of grace boldly in the time of need. When is the time of need? When you're sinning. But we won't do that. How many people, don't raise your hands, but how many people have had the mindset that you've learned from church? I know people that don't go to church because they're sick. Where should we be going when we're sick? The Bible says, say the Bible.
Bible.
I'm sorry, I get carried away. The Bible says, when you're sick, call the
elders.
Where are they at?
Church.
By the way, if you don't know, that is one of the qualifications of an elder that never gets talked about in a church. The qualification of an elder of the church, in addition to the ones in Timothy, is you got to believe in healing and laying hands on people and see them recover. Mm-hmm. Busted a bunch of them, didn't I? Yeah, buddy. Yeah. The church that Jesus orchestrates, the elders will believe in laying on of hands, anointing of oil, and watching the sick recover. What church are you going to? I'm sorry. I'm meddling. I'm glad. If this is on YouTube, I'd be getting slapped. No, I wouldn't. YouTube stuff, like people like this stuff. Let me read that again. But let him ask in what?
Faith.
Not doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave, the sea driven and tossed by wind. Next verse. For let not that man, which man? The one that is doubting in who he is in Christ. He's judging himself according to his performance. Got this? The man that's judging himself according to his performance. Let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the
Lord.
The word receive doesn't mean, well, I didn't get nothing. This is a Greek word called lambono. Everybody say lambono. That's kind of a nice little, that's a Greek word. Lambono. That's kind of an easy one to remember. There's some Greek words hard to remember. But the word received in the Greek here is lambono. It doesn't mean that God's not going to give you thing if you doubt in your mind, if you're using your faith and you doubt. It's not saying God's not going to give you anything, because everything that God has for us has already been what? Given. All the promises of God are what?
Yes
and amen. Lambono means if you have your... Take these. Give them to me. I can't read any further. Give them to me. Just toss them over. Lambono means you couldn't take what was given. It's like jumping into a swimming pool with your hands tied. It's like walking through a candy store and not being able to touch anything. You don't have the ability to take what's there. So a man that doubts, has faith, whatever he asks, if he asks in faith and does not doubt, even though it's already all there, it's like walking through the kingdom of heaven going, oh, I wish I could partake of all this goodness. I wish I had peace and joy in my life and happiness in the midst of a storm. I wished I could hear the word of God tell me my purpose so when I go through trials and tribulations, I can have patience to make it through the other side. But guess what?
Thank you.
As long as you have lambono, it's a new disease that just came in. Christians have a lambono disease. Let's read what it says. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will lambono anything from the Lord. He won't be able to partake. This has popped up in my head, so I got to tell you. It's just the way it works, okay? The Jewish people, when you hear what they have to say about heaven, it's entirely different than what we think heaven is like, okay? Their concept of heaven and hell is in the same place. Okay? It's like a long banqueting table, a big room. And you have people on both sides of this table. And it's full of food, all kinds of delicacies and great things and things to eat. And the people that are in hell, their arms don't have hands. From their elbows up, it's like a giant fork. And from this arm, it's like a giant spoon reaching way out like this, okay? And for them, hell is like having all this available to them, but they can't, they reach in there and get some of that mashed potatoes and gravy. I said that for her sake, because we love mashed potatoes and gravy. And it's like getting all, you know, or some of fancy, mention a fancy dish.
Sushi.
Yeah, that's right. That's hell, all right. No.
Brisket. Brisket.
Brisket. Yeah. Banana pudding. Pudding. The way it's,
okay,
but it's like brisket. Having pudding on this spoon and brisket on this fork. And guess what? You can't get it. The spoon forks too. Hell is this to you. You having everything that's there, but you can't get any of it. Heaven, on the other hand, is just the opposite in the same room. Heaven is taking a bite, a big old fork of brisket, and a big old spoon of a banana pudding, and I look at Dave, and I reach over, and I feed Dave the brisket.
Amen. Amen.
And he gets done chewing that.
I'm scooping for you.
I give him some banana pudding, and he goes, "Oh, Curtis, that's real good. Open up. Here it comes, boy." And I go, heaven is when you prefer your brother in life instead of yourself.
Well, you left me out.
I did. Okay. It's like when you're reaching that bowl of chitlins. Because nobody else wants them. Nobody else wants them, Linda.
It's on a long stick.
Keep them off the table, okay? Verse 7. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. So if you don't see yourself, if you doubt your value, the way God sees you, you will be unstable in all your ways. And life will be hell on earth, even though you're going to heaven someday. Father, we thank you for this time you've given us to be together. Holy Spirit, you're the great teacher. We simply ask that you do what you do best. Open the eyes of our understanding. Bring to us a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of how you see us and who we really are. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen.